This week, I wanted to do a video pretty much focusing on the issues of the social construct theory. Now, you may recall I kind of briefly went into this when I talked about the issue of Rachel Dozal and transracialism, which I don't believe actually exists and is actually racist in nature. But the whole idea that I'm going into is the social construct theory, basically broadening the ideas on the issue of race, gender, even so much as sexual identity, and trying to reiterate the issue that while we need to recognize everyone as just human beings that, you know, are equal in the eyes of, you know, nature and everything else, at the same time, we cannot, you know, I'm basically going to then reiterate the whole idea that we cannot, you know, fight against the social construct without acknowledging that it exists and doing what we can to fight against it. So it's one of those kind of hypocrisies in its own self. At the same time, it's something that has to be addressed. So, yeah. So, I'm just pretty much going to go into it. What is the social construct? Well, a social construct is, in a broad sense of the definition, it's a mechanism, phenomenon, or category created and developed by society. A perception of an individual, group, or idea that is technically constructed. It's the byproducts of countless human choices rather than laws relating to human judgment. Now, further to go into this whole idea is the idea that we are all, you know, essentially, it was something that was created by, well, let's just be honest, imperialists. It was created by capitalism. It was created by a lot of different groups to differentiate between, you know, gender, between race, but, you know, pretty much it started with a very white superiority sort of Eurocentric sort of belief from the get-go. Now, there's been social constructs that's not just been Eurocentric. I mean, social constructs have been around for thousands of years. I mean, so much as, like, one of the things that has been used to differentiate between different civilizations and the Jewish ethnicity. For example, in Egypt, you know, that is probably one of the most common things. There's been persecution of Jews throughout, you know, the history, in whether it was Egypt, whether it was in Persia, whether it was in Rome, there was always some sort of persecution, and pretty much this whole social construct has been in this ideal to, for the most part, oppress a certain group of people over the years. And, you know, this soon came along with the advent of Christianity, with the rise of European imperialism, everything else. And it was one of those things that pretty much right around the age of imperialism, so about, you know, the 13, 14, 1500s, that social construct became a major part of what, you know, has become a very white superior, white supremacist sort of fervor, in a sense. that still lingers to this day. And obviously one of the major social constructs was, you know, was race issues. And it was used to differentiate between let's be honest, Europeans, white people, and typically Africans and later African Americans. It was one of those things that was used to discriminate against people because of their skin color. And so that whole idea of social construct became a real black spot, you know, no pun intended, on, you know, the face of the world. So it soon became one of those really underlying issues that has unfortunately never really gone away. But it's obviously not just to discriminate against people who happened to be of a different skin color. It also was it's been used for thousands of years to also discriminate against, let's just be honest, it's one of those things that's been used to also oppress women. One of the major flaws of social construct is the fact that one of the sad parts of the social construct theory is the fact that, there's men and there's women, and men are stereotypically supposed to be the macho, the hunters, the predators, the people that take care of the household and that are powerful and fertile and potent and all that macho mumbo jumbo bullshit. And that women are supposed to be these petite, fragile gatherer beings that are supposed to take care of the house and the children and cook the food and all that sort of, misogynistic bullshit. And it's one of those things where that social construct still even exists to this day. Granted, it's more watered down, thankfully, but there's, those issues still exist. Misogyny still exists. And the sad part about misogyny is that the social construct theory and with all that is that there's people that then claim claim misandry, which is the idea that males are the ones that are oppressed and persecuted. One of those men's rights sort of, fuck all bullshit. And I'm sorry, but I don't believe in misandry. I don't really believe. I believe that it exists in a very minor form, much like the idea that Christian persecution exists. But the idea that you are already a oppressor class, a group that has privilege over, let's be honest, other citizens, you hold a great amount of privilege, that doesn't really exist. It is basic, yes. Do people get discriminated against because they're male? Yes, in a minor aspect. Are Christians persecuted? Yes, in a minor aspect. But it does not mean that you are, as an entire group, are an oppressed, persecuted class. You are it's quite the contrary. You are the oppressor class. You are the privileged class. You are the ruling class. Therefore, it's kind of hard to be in a oppressed group when you are the oppressor. Kind of see where I'm going with that one? So, that's why I don't believe in that whole misandry bullshit. I believe in misogyny, because misogyny is a very big issue. It's one of those big issues that's, perpetrated by the oppressing ruling class, which is typically white, Christian, males. And not that you have to be Christian, but the point is, if you are white, Christian, and male, you are very privileged. In fact, the very idea that you are male, you are privileged. The very idea that you are white, you are privileged. Thus, white privilege. Thus, male privilege. Thus, Christian hegemony and Christian privilege. That's all part of the whole social construct, is that there's always been somebody that is up at the top, that is the ruling class, the oppressor class, while there's always been someone that has been subordinate to them. And that's one of the major problems that, you know, that is basically one of the biggest issues with the social construct theory. It is very class-based, it is very, well, capitalist-based, because, let's be honest, without a social construct, without the idea of actual class, there would be no capitalism. If you had, in fact, and that's why communists, Marxists, a lot, you know, us that actually believe in revolutionary ideology, typically tend to view the social construct with a very critical and, you know, and just plain, yeah, we view it with a very negative viewpoint, you know, much as we, because it does represent a class-based society, and that is something that we fight against. Thus, how we always talk about the idea of class warfare, and the idea that we need to, you know, unite the classes together to overthrow the actual ruling class, because we as the proletariat are deserving to have everyone be equal, to have everyone, you know, strive for the greater good of the people themselves, and do this all within the confines of equality and not a class-based bullshit society. And so, again, that whole idea of the social construct is a bit of a pain in the ass. Now, again, the whole idea of the social construct also goes back to the ideas of race issues. Race is another thing that has been constructed by human society, primarily the Eurocentric society, but let's just be honest, it has always been a way to oppress, to have a ruling class oppressing another group of people, such as, again, the Egyptians, the Egyptian Empire that existed, you know, a couple thousand years ago, when they, you know, oppressed the Jewish people. The Egyptians were the ruling class. They were the, you know, and had based a social construct that they were the superior or inferior to them. Thus, that was a form of social construct. Jewish people were second-class citizens, and that was one of the underlying issues that existed there. So, you know, again, the Egyptians were the ruling class, while the Jewish people were the oppressed class. Plain and simple, that should not be rocket science. We have Rome, which also oppressed the Jewish people, but Rome was also very aristocratic, very oligarchic, and, well, autocratic in most cases. So, essentially, moreover, while the Jewish people were a part of the social construct of being one of the oppressed classes, so were, you know, in some aspects, women from time to time. You had, for a certain time, Christians were persecuted, although they did a lot of persecuting. And then when Christians gained a major foothold in Western society, they became the persecutors and the oppressors and everything else. It soon became one of those issues that really became part of that social construct of oppressing the people. And overall, it was just the rich. It was just the rich that were oppressing the poorer classes. In a lot of cases, there were a lot of, especially emperors, that would be taxing the shit out of the people and collecting all that money to spend on their lavish lifestyles. This is all starting to sound very familiar. Anyway, the idea was that the rich were oppressing the working classes and the middle classes. Again, this is starting to sound eerily familiar. It's one of those things where there was, again, a ruling class in every aspect and an oppressed class in that society. Again, it's all social construct is all part of someone wielding a ruling class position while, you know, while oppressing a lower class, a lower class of individuals. It was always, there was always a ruling class and oppressed class. Pretty much throughout history, this is how social construct has worked. And that's why, again, I say that this is, that social construct is a very imperialistic and capitalistic sort of theory, so a very part of that ideology. The idea that also when we reach the Renaissance era and the Dark Ages and things like that, where the different feudal kingdoms of Europe, predominantly very controlled by the Catholic Church, were persecuting scientists, were persecuting pagans and witches and everybody like that. That was a very hierarchical sort of social construct sort of idea, where the church and essentially the state as well, sometimes interchangeably and intertwined, but still at the same time, you know, the church was still the higher level, the government, the state governments were below that. Essentially, it was kind of in a way like a federal union of basically theocratic monarchies, pretty much. And this, and with basically the Pope as, like, you know, the head guy. And the between the church and the state, they continued, those were the ruling classes that continued to oppress many of the working poor, continued to oppress people that were not of the church, that resulting even to killing people. They oppressed women, they oppressed Jews, they oppressed, you know, they pretty much oppressed anybody that was not, you know, that was basically not at least loyal to these, to this system at the time, or loyal to the church. So that was a form of social construct. That was a form of religious, of a socio-political sort of aspect, a very religious social construct. Trying to think of more examples. One obvious one was obviously Nazi Germany. It had its own very, very social, big social construct, with, you know, the pretty much anyone that was not viewed as, you know, white, Anglo-Saxon, you know, basically anybody that wasn't white, Christian, / Protestant, whatever, and wasn't, and wasn't basically German, was considered a lower form of class, and because of that were persecuted, if not exterminated, because of their beliefs or who they were, you know. So the Nazi Party itself was the, again, this is all obvious and spoken many a time, not just by me and Marxists, but everybody. This has been, you know, the Nazis were the ruling class, while pretty much anybody that was not part of the party or was not, you know, or did not pledge allegiance to the party and to Adolf Hitler were considered the lower classes and were greatly, if not murderously, oppressed. And so that was all part of the social construct of that, of pretty much of World War II in Europe. And then there's just so many different social constructs. Even here in the United States, there's a large social construct issue, especially between whites and black people and Latino people. Not that it doesn't happen in the Asian community as well, with white people persecuting Asians, especially there was a lot of persecuting of Asian people during World War II because of the whole Japanese thing, but it was essentially these folks were, yeah, but essentially these folks ended up gaining a secondary level privilege position in today's modern society, and the people that tend to be persecuted now are black people and Latino people. I mean, this is not really a surprising thing. I mean, with the blatant xenophobia regarding, you know, regarding anti-immigration policies and people that are ardently opposed to it, whether they just believe we've got too many people here, or whether they're just blatantly xenophobic, it still doesn't really matter. There's a large, you know, discrimination amongst not only politicians but Americans when it comes to Latinos. And then when it comes to African Americans, you know, while people hide and disguise their racism in different forms and shapes, it's one of those things where there is still a lot of, you know, blatant racism when it comes, you know, especially with people that are out there screaming "All Lives Matter" or "Cop Lives Matter," you know, and all that different shit. When it's the police that are doing the oppressing and killing folks, you know, Mike Brown, Sandra Bland, you know, it's one of those things where it's really quite, you know, the people that are actually going out and defending the police force, when the police force had been militarizing for years, are out there committing crimes, what are literally crimes against humanity, almost tantamount to war crimes, as they basically are engaging in war on the people. People that have been brought in and have been tortured in police detention. And people still go out and defend them. These torture centers, detention centers that were found in Chicago, and people are still outright defending the police. Now, granted, I'll definitely throw a bone out there. Now, I mean, to say that all police are doing wrong is a bit ignorant and a bit over the top. There are still police that do actually do some good. But the issue is that they make the conscientious decision to put on the uniform, to put on the badge. Once that happens, they're basically, their job is to pretty much go out there and to pretty much enforce the laws of the state, to basically be the Republican Guard, essentially, to be the statist guard of the ruling class. They're out there to protect the rule of the bourgeoisie. They're not there to defend the rights of people. They are not there to serve and protect. The Supreme Court ruled on that in 2006. They are not bound by the idea that they're supposed to serve and protect the community. They're there to enforce bourgeois law. And bourgeois law, as we've seen, and as it's getting now, is getting more and more draconian, oppressive, and totalitarian. So, it's one of those things where it's quite, they're not there to defend us or anything like that. It has gotten very more dystopian as time goes along. And the fact that we see that many of the policemen that commit these crimes against, you know, like Mike Brown, against Sandra Bland, that have committed it against Tamir Rice and everybody else, these have been issues that the reason why it's been not only the police have been pretty much the ones that have been targeted, but it's also been predominantly white policemen, because white policemen are the ones that are actually committing these crimes. Now, black policemen do the same thing. It doesn't matter white, black, or brown, whether, you know, who you are. If you're on the force, you basically have, you know, you're there to do the same job regardless. However, many more people of color have actually spoken out on these issues and have even put their entire careers on the line, because that, you know, they see what is happening in the communities that they've originally come from, or the communities that, you know, that they serve and protect, or just the community in general where these crimes are happening, and they're speaking out against that. Now, there are some white policemen that do the same thing. However, the issue still remains that it is still that the police have a very the police that are committing these crimes typically tend to be white Anglo-Saxon Protestant white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, or WASP, as this acronym is made, these WASP policemen are the ones that are committing these crimes. And that's why whenever Marxists like myself or Jason Unruh, Scottish Socialist, or Red Scare TV or whatever, whenever they make these sort of statements and stuff like that, we talk about white supremacy because there is a very white supremacist mentality, whether it's out blatantly outright or whether it's watered down. It doesn't matter. There is a very white supremacist mentality that exists within the police force, that exists within the militarized police, or military police, paramilitary, whatever you want to call it. It exists within that sector. And the people that tend to defend more of the police rights also tends to be middle-class white people. People that have never faced working-class oppression, that have never faced discrimination because of their skin color, that have never faced, you know, any sort of real oppression other than maybe their property rights. That's not oppression. That is, in fact, that's very much more a white person, white privileged sort of mentality. And to say that police brutality and that the police are not at fault and to be victim blaming people like that, that is a very white supremacist mentality to have. So that's why that falls within that whole idea of the social construct. It's the very nature that white people are in America. I'm whether mildly or out or you know highly are in some have some case of white you know white people have white privilege, let's just put it that way. There's also certain levels of the white community that have a very Eurocentric, white supremacist, and white colonizer mentality, very first worldist mentality, and don't ever really think about the people that are being oppressed. They don't really actually think about you know what went on and certain aspects of things like that. They don't understand what it's like to be oppressed. Now, you could make the argument about your religion, you can make an argument about your political affiliation, you can make an argument about your sexual identity, you can make a different thing like that. But the point is, if you are basically, it doesn't matter, you do not know what it is like to be a person of color being oppressed and beaten down by the police. You do not know what that aspect is like. So you are not exactly a person to be speaking on that issue. Now, if this is a case where you are a white female, let's put a good scenario together. A white trans woman. Now, yes, you do know what it's like to be oppressed. You do know what it's like to be, you know, discriminated against. You do know what it's like to be, you know what it's like to, you know, to have to live in fear. That does not necessarily mean, though, that you are being oppressed by the police, although there are some, there are a lot of individuals, much like the individuals that I'm describing, that have faced that sort of fear, that sort of discrimination. But it's hard, but at the same time, the whole idea of being white, you still have privilege. However, you don't, at the same time, we cannot also take away the idea that you don't have as much privilege as, say, a white, straight, male Christian, for instance. This is just kind of, you know, apples and oranges sort of things that we're throwing out. We could go into different scenarios talking about it. It's not necessarily relevant to this video. The point that I'm trying to make is that typically the whole idea of the social construct is that it is the division of individuals that are by race, by gender, and one that I have not talked about that I'm going to now speak on now is the idea of the idea of sexual identity. Now, we also, now, granted, there's a certain level of it that exists and needs to exist for a reason. I mean, this is one of the hypocrisies of the social construct, that while we can be critical of the idea and want to eventually get rid of the idea of social construct and just think of everybody as human beings, we have to still acknowledge the fact that certain divisions in our society still exist. One of those divisions is the idea over sexual identity and identity politics. Now, I am a Marxist who doesn't like the idea of identity politics, but we are drawn to the idea of identity politics for the idea of the fact that we're trying to encourage people to come over to the trying to revolutionize, radicalize, and trying to gain support from people of that particular community, and trying to say, come fight for us, we will fight for you, and we can get rid of this system and this, of exploitation and everything else. It's one of those issues. But anyway, let's focus back in here. The idea of sexual identities, whether you're gay, lesbian, bisexual, trans, transgender, pansexual, asexual, gender non-binary, as a friend of mine says, alphabet soup. It's one of those things where it's a very large part of the social construct. The reason why it is such a big issue, why identity politics is such a big issue, why this has become a major part of the social construct today, is because of the mass oppression that these individuals face on almost a daily basis, almost on an hourly basis, because of who they are, who they were born as, and who they identify as. It's one of those things where this has become a major part of the idea, because they too are part of the oppressed class. And we talk about the whole idea of social construct earlier about the ruling class, a typical ruling class being typically white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, straight males. That's typically those five things right there, is the fact that they are, white, they're typically tend to be Eurocentric, Christian, Protestant, Catholic, whatever the case, Christian, Judeo, the male, straight, those types of aspects. It's one of those things where those are the people that tend to be up there in the ruling class, and unless you fit within that ruling class, you are typically oppressed. And the fact that you also tend to have to be at least middle class or rich, by the way, to also have any sort of ruling class or secondary class position within that society. Otherwise, you are part of the oppressed class. This does not mean that you don't at some point have privilege. Again, if you're white, you have white privilege. If you're male, you have male privilege. If you're straight, you have straight privilege. If you have, if you're Christian, you have Christian privilege. All that saying, though, it's kind of a very all or nothing sort of thing. if you have privilege, but you can also be oppressed, but you also have to at the same time check your privilege. But that's not taking away from the fact that you can be oppressed in another aspect. So, for instance, I am white, I am straight. What was the other one I talked about? And I'm male. I'm white, straight, and male. I fit three of those categories. I know that I have male privilege. I know I have heterosexual privilege, and I know I have white. And I know I have white privilege. I know I have those aspects. However, I'm also pagan, Wiccan, and pagan. So therefore, my people have been discriminated against, and are still discriminated against religiously. And even before that, I was atheist, so I was also heavily persecuted for that as well. At the same time, there are times where I don't know which one is more persecuted. The Wiccans and pagans are more persecuted, that's a given. But typically, there's a lot of discrimination that goes on, and I've had arguments with people in the past over that. But today, historically, there's been a lot more persecution against the polytheistic groups than the atheistic. Today, I would say that they're fairly even. That's just my personal opinion from it. But then again, I also live in California where, yeah, people either don't care or the discrimination's pretty fairly even. But it's also, and that also depends. In fact, we could even go into talking about what region or state you live in, because there's a level of privilege that exists there too. But realistically, let's look at the whole idea of, the fact that I am not Christian, and I, am not, I'm part of a working class community. I am part of, I come from a working class family. So it's typically one of those things where I do not have certain privileges that, necessarily would be part of that dynamic. But I do have a certain level of privilege in society. Now, the whole idea of, and I know that I have more privilege than, say, my trans friend, for instance, or my gay friend, or my lesbian friend, or whatever the case may be. As a straight, white, straight male, I have more privilege than, say, my white, gay friend. I have way more privilege, in that aspect, especially considering the fact that, the fact that I do not know what it's like to go through their struggle. And that's being the keen idea, is that people of the LGBTQ+ community, they face a strong level of oppression from the ruling class all the time. And that's because pretty much up until a couple of years ago, the idea of being, lesbian, gay, or bisexual was almost a taboo in the United States, and it wasn't even a subject that we were willing to even begin talking about pretty much up until the 2000s. That's how much that became an issue. However, as the years went on, the fight escalated and eventually culminating this past June with marriage equality. Now, that's not taking away the other acts of discrimination that still exist, but, that's one major victory in itself. The trans community, however, they have a large level of discrimination that still exists against them. More so, I would even say, and I know this will probably piss some people off in the LGB community, but trans individuals have faced larger amounts of discrimination, still face larger amounts of discrimination and oppression from the ruling class than the LGB community. Their struggle is similar in nature, but even in that aspect, LGB individuals, I would even go as far to say, do have certain amounts of privileges, do have not certain amounts, but they do have a certain level of privilege over trans individuals. I would, you know, feel free to debate me on that. That's, you know, feel, you know, that's your prerogative. My personal opinion is, from my observation, has seen that. I mean, obviously, with the gay community having been given this concession by the ruling class is definitely a victory, and it's something, and it's more of a concession than the trans community has received. They've been given more acceptance in society than the trans community has. I mean, I go on message boards, I go on comment sections, and I go on different things, and I just see the level of transphobia that exists. And I think back to even as recent as 2008, with the issue going on in California, which was just surprisingly one of the biggest hotbeds of debate over this. And we all have to remember that in 2008, people, by a slim majority, voted to discriminate against the LGBT community. They voted to deny them same-sex marriage. And it's one of those issues that we have to realize that back, even I say back then, like it was 50 years ago, but it was in some aspects almost, you know, it seems like a decade ago, when this, where there was so much hatred and homophobia and discrimination against people of the LGBT community. And that level of homophobia and the fact that people didn't understand and weren't educated to the idea of what gay people represented, that slowly began to subside, and more people grew to accept it. I mean, obviously, now there's 60% of the American population that is accepting in some form or another, you know, of same-sex marriage and of the gay community. That's a large, that is a larger number that existed from like 10 years ago, because back then that number was like probably 37%, because people didn't even understand what, you know, back 10 years ago there was still a lot of people in America that didn't even know what gay meant, or what lesbian meant, or what bisexual meant. They didn't understand, and they discriminated against it because, you know, lack of education means lack of understanding, and that propagates fear, that propagates hatred. You know, I could go into a Yoda sort of thing about that, but, you know, and I see the same shit that existed against LGBT people, I see that shit exist with people against the trans community, especially, but obviously between with people who are heterosexual against the trans community, but I also see it against people who are gay and lesbian that discriminate against the trans community, and that's just not acceptable. That level of lack of understanding, lack of education, and the fear-mongering that exists propagates that hatred, propagates that sort of issue. And this is why I end up in heated debates with people and start screaming, you know, at these people. Like there's literally gotten to the point where I've started literally screaming at people through the computer, because I was so pissed the fuck off by the level by the offensive comments that I've seen, or the offensive memes that have been posted. It, you know, and it really, and that's what has propagated me with that whole idea that yes, the trans community is still vastly oppressed. In fact, in the tier level of it, we could probably say that, you know, ruling class is like way up here at the top of the camera screen. LGBTs have probably made it to about right here, and the trans community is still like right down here, and then we have a whole bunch of other people that are kind of intertwined within that. But let's put it this way. The LGB community, still heavily oppressed. No doubt about that, not taking away anything about that. The trans community, however, is still vastly oppressed below the LGB community. The LGB community still has now been able to gain a level of acceptance, a level of, you know, has been able to latch on to some level of privilege and gain some level of rights. While the trans community is still outnumbered, as far, you know, in a matter of speaking, they're it really is quite sad, because we're only within this last year. I actually had this conversation with my grandmother the other day, who actually is fairly accepting of the trans community, and my grandmother is like 60 something. And again, you have to consider, my grandmother came from a lot of time, from the same time, grew up in the same family dynamic, where there was a lot of very, you know, traditionalist American values, conservatism, things like that. She grew up in, my grandmother grew up in a Lutheran family, and was Methodist. Today, she doesn't really have, you know, she has a skeptical view and everything like that. I'm not going to get too much into it. But the point is that she is accepting of a lot of things. Now, granted, she's also been educated, you know, she and I have also kind of learned as we go along. You know, I learn new things and I, you know, educate her and talk to her and my mom about this. And, you know, in my family, there's definitely a certain level of acceptance, at least in the immediate family. My extended family, I don't even want to go into. But, you know, there's certain members that are accepting to some level. There's some that don't really understand it, but are still somewhat accepting. And then there's others that just, I don't even want to go into it. But the whole point is that I try to educate people and everything else. You know, I did have this conversation, though, about how, you know, again, about how the LGB community does have a certain level more privilege, and trans people are pretty much still stuck, you know, like how the trans people pretty much are, trans individuals are stuck back in a level of, like, 80s, 90s sort of limbo, as far as rights go. In fact, it was one of those things that I was even went as so far to say is trans rights has only become like a major issue like as of this year. And maybe a little bit, it started kind of gaining a movement within the last year, maybe 2 years, but the people that have actually started educating themselves and latching on to acceptance and understanding and all that, even myself, I will admit, has only started gaining this momentum as of just this year in 2015. It's like the movement has only started to gain, you know, help and support in 2015. Okay, we're talking about what? 50 years after the civil rights movement, and we're talking about after almost, you know, a good 20, 30 years of fighting for LGB equality, and only just now getting LGB marriage equality in 2015. And we're only now talking about the trans rights issue, because the problem is that the trans rights movement has been so stifled by the LGB community for years that it has really become, it's become almost a social construct in its own self. And so that right there has become a huge sort of divide within that own community, that community on its own. And then, you know, there's issues with the and I'm not going to talk about it because my knowledge of it is very slim to none, but the idea of cis males and cis females and their views on the trans community and everything like that, I got friends that could probably explain that way better than I could. Hopefully at some point I might be able to get them on here and talk about it, but there's definitely a lot of divide and a lot more of a of this issue, these issues that are going on. Anyway, the point being is that is a part of a social construct. And again, that whole idea that people that are, typically tend to be straight have a lot, typically discriminate against LGBTs and definitely against transgender individuals and in different aspects of the LGBT plus community, this dynamic still exists, and whether we like it or not, that is part of a social construct, is that straight individuals hold a ruling class position over the LGBT plus community. The LGB community holds a level of privilege, and I will even go so far as to say even a slightly ruling class position. If we look at it in that community itself, they hold a ruling class position over everyone else. So, like I said, there's a social construct issue within that social construct issue, within another social construct issue, and it's we could start making a Venn diagram of bubbles here. It is literally one of those things where it's hard to tell where one social construct issue ends, where another begins, and if we look at it in because we cannot just look at it in its, in one bubble, because there's so many different levels to it. But yes, the social construct is a issue that affects when it comes down to race, it affects gender, it affects sexual identity, the working class, obviously, against the ruling class, against the against the middle class and the upper classes, and the middle class against the upper class, that social dynamic and stuff like that. There's so many different levels to this, and it's one of those things that I could probably go on talking about it for another couple hours, but I don't think anybody wants to hear me babble that long about it. But the three main big ones that I wanted to knock out and talk about were race, sexual identity, and gender. Those are major issues within a social construct. Now, to sum it all up, the social construct itself was again something that was created by imperialistic and capitalistic interest. It started back in ancient times and was escalated only by imperialist capitalism predominantly during the 13, 14, 15, 1600s. That's when it became pre-Enlightenment era. That's when that social construct became a major issue, because that began dividing people by race. It's been dividing people by gender since pretty much, well, definitely since about ancient times, but it didn't really escalate until about the Dark Ages and the feudalism era and stuff like that, and the issue of people that were, that happened to be of, that were, homosexual, transgender, all these different things. That was a thing that I think the social construct has probably always existed, but was never widely talked about, but definitely escalated the discrimination definitely escalated, I would say, probably within the last 150 to 200 years. Definitely was escalated under the rule of the Nazis, and was escalated in the Western world over the, you know, during the last century. The social construct, again, it exists as a means, usually as a means of oppression by the ruling class over the over whatever group of individuals they are oppressing. It is a means to divide us and conquer us through that means of imperialism, through that means of colonialism, through that means of, you know, some form of supremacy. The social construct theory exists because of that. We have to acknowledge that it exists, much like we have to acknowledge white privilege exists, that we have to acknowledge that xenophobia, homophobia, transphobia, that exists, that anti-Semitism exists, and fascism exists as well. We have to acknowledge that these fabrics of society exist so that we can fight against it, that we can vehemently oppose it, and at the end of the day, hope to eradicate those types of discrimination, those forms of oppression, that form of exploitation. And the way that we go about that is abolishing the system that propagates it. That in itself will definitely help to crumble those different tiers of wild tyranny, and eventually begin to crack and divide that social construct to the point where we can all view each other as equals and as human beings, regardless of, you know, our skin color, regardless of, you know, male or female, or, you know, gender non-binary, regardless of, you know, whether we're gay, straight, lesbian, bi, transgender, pansexual, intersex, asexual, whatever the case may be. No matter what our religions, or non-religions, whatever our nationality, ethnicity, whatever, wouldn't matter. Or how much money we had or didn't, it wouldn't matter. Because again, when we come into this world, we are all the same people. When we die, we have nothing to take with us anyway. At the end of our, you know, when you look at it from the bigger perspective, there's no reason to discriminate. There's no necessity for a social construct. There's no necessity for creating more profit for ourselves and everything else, because at the end of the day, we're not going to take those dynamics with us, you know. And depending on what your, you know, your views are and stuff like that, you may or may not be judged for it in the afterlife, but that's not relevant. When we peel back the skin, we are all human beings. We all have the same organs, the same heart, we all bleed red, we all have the same nervous systems, everything else. We are all human beings. Can we fucking learn to treat each other as such? That's the point I try to make. That is what being a human being, and why I personally believe the social construct theory exists for good and bad, for positive and negative reasons. Many of them negative, because again, the social construct theory is a very convoluted and very imperialistic aspect. However, we have to definitely acknowledge it, and in some cases even give into it some ways, in order to crumble it, because the only way to actually destroy it is to destroy it from the inside out. That's pretty much also the nature of how Marxists go about trying to fight back against capitalism. We find it, that's not necessarily true. We find it from both ends. We try to destroy it from the inside out and from the outside in. It's kind of like digging a tunnel. It's kind of like how they did when they dug the Channel Tunnel. Think about trying to, you know, excavate it and everything else. But yeah, the social construct theory is, at the end of the day, is definitely a very dangerous, and it's a very, it's an ideology meant to basically, that at the end of the day only does nothing but to destroy society by dividing it and trying to conquer it through, but for means of political and economic and oftentimes even religious power. It's one of those things where it is a very sad and just, it's a dynamic that really is sad that it even has to still exist. But at the end of the day, all we can do is hope to try to fight back against these different social dynamics so that we can one day we can eliminate those forms of discrimination and poverty and everything else, and look back and just look at ourselves as human beings, and that everyone gets along in, you know, to some degree with very little, you know, discrimination and very little oppression, and little to no oppression at all. That is a society that we need. At the same time, we are human beings, so we're always looking for competition and struggle. But there are other means and other positive and more productive means of struggle and competition. That doesn't mean attacking someone because of the person that they are. So, yeah. At the end of the day, this is all just banter, but, and looking towards a future of post-capitalism is what I'm trying to say, some form of it, not necessarily looking for a utopia, you know, because I know that there's people that are probably going to be saying, you know, I've got this utopic sort of ideology, and it's not so much of a utopia, it's more of just the idea of, you know, can we have more of a humanistic sort of view on the world, a more humanistic view of ourselves and everything else, and just treat each other as equal human beings, you know, anyway, hopefully you get the idea, and hopefully this has been a bit informative and stuff like that, and has given you something to kind of think about. This was definitely a video I wanted to do, because there was actually a couple other things that I probably am going to get to within this next week, or probably will put out in the next couple of weeks, but this was something that actually came to me while I was actually laying in bed one morning, very struggling to get a little bit more sleep, and these ideas were just coming to me, and I'm like, I'm going to do a video on this. Originally, I was going to do a blog, but I kind of got caught up in how I was going to try to write this and realized I'm not going to have time to actually think this all out thoroughly and put it out, on, at least not on time. Maybe I'll get to it at some point, maybe not, but definitely wanted to get my thoughts out there. And what are your thoughts, actually, on the idea of social construct theory? Anything I said, do you agree, do you disagree, do you think that I'm on the nose, do you think I'm full of crap? Feel free to just debate with me, because this is actually something that there's certain comments I'll get that I'll probably be a bit more argumentative, especially if they're, you know, certain kind of offensive, but to be honest, this is one of those issues where I'm going to be a bit more open to talking about, because this is an issue that is more of an opinion piece on my part. It's fact-based in some cases, but it also is more of an opinion piece as it goes along. And that's why I kind of want your guys' opinion. So, but that way we can kind of engage on that. We get a whole bunch of views. So this one is probably going to be a video where I might comment back on certain different things, but probably will leave it more to my audience to discuss and stuff like that with each other. Maybe see me engage a little bit in it, but yeah, I'm just setting the bar for a discussion. So yeah, thank you for listening, guys. Don't forget to hit me up on Twitter at _NickLucian, facebook.com/NorCalNick, facebook.com/NorCalCorner, NorCalCorner.tumblr.com, you can go there, hit the subscribe button, and yeah, I think I've hoarded myself enough. Thank you guys so much this week for listening. Hope y'all liked it, and hopefully this strikes up an interesting discussion. So I'm NorCal Nick, leader of the revolutionist movement, and this has been NorCal Corner for this week. Peace.